May I hold it? Oh, it's adorable. What is it?
What is it? Why, lovely lady, it's a tribble.
A tribble?
Only the sweetest creature known to man.
Lieutenant Uhura, open the hailing frequency.
Hailing frequencies open. Is opening a channel to bring in communication from whomever.
Hailing frequencies open, sir.
On the ship, outside the ship, on other planets, our home planet, and is the vital organ of the functioning of that ship aside from engineering.
Hailing frequencies open, sir.
You know, without communication and without out of motor, you can't go.
Channel is open, Mr. Scott, and you are tied in.
It was sort of like beam me up, Scotty, although Scotty never said beam me up.
Hailing frequency still open.
I said hailing frequencies open about 10,000 times. But when that frequency was being opened, there was an urgency about whatever was going on.
Nothing, Captain. Hailing frequencies are open.
It was my job. It was Uhura's job. And she did her job well.
They used to say if man could fly, he'd have wings. But he did fly. He discovered he had to.
Well, it isn't so much seeing the vulnerable side of a command figure as I think it is the actor and all the other elements, of course, the writer and director and cinematographer, who combine to tap an emotion.
Do you wish that the first Apollo mission hadn't reached the moon, or that we hadn't gone on to Mars and then to the nearest star?
And everybody should be doing that, even, and that is what goes wrong with many science fiction films, that essentially the director forgets in the enormity of what he's responsible for, that what really is important is not the tremendous computer-generated image behind me that's exploding, but it's what's happening in my eyes.
Because Dr. McCoy is right in pointing out the enormous danger potential.
Is that making me afraid? Is there something coming at me? Was that destroyed? Something I loved? You know, it's the human emotion that goes from moment to moment that is the most important thing. So although there may not have been outright fireworks of emotion, all the time I was looking for what is meaningful here to this character.
Risk. Risk is our business. That's what the starship is all about. That's why we're aboard her.
Are you all right?
Yes, I believe no permanent damage was done.
What happened?
The occipital area of my head seems to have impacted with the arm of the chair.
No, Mr. Spock, I meant, what happened to us?
Well, I suggest we return to our starting place at top warp speed.
Aye, sir. But even at that, it'll take us a while to get there.
In that case, Mr. Scott, I suggest we start at once. Can you give me warp 8?
Aye, sir. And maybe a wee bit more. I'll sit on the warp engines myself and nurse them.
That position, Mr. Scott, would not only be unavailing, but also undignified.
Why can't I blow off just one of his ears?
You green-blooded half-breed!
May I say that I have not thoroughly enjoyed serving with humans. I find their illogic and foolish emotions a constant irritant.
Then transfer out, freak!
Mr. Spock, what are the chances of the captain and the others being alive?
Lieutenant, we are not engaged in gambling. We are proceeding in the only logical way to return to the place they were last seen and factually ascertain whether or not they still live.
Yes, Mr. Spock.
I do not want to command the Enterprise, but if it should befall me, I suggest you remember that my operatives would avenge my death. And some of them are Vulcans.
In the 60s, when we were making the show, being cool was important somehow. And if there ever was a cool character, Spock was cool. I appreciated that. What, among other things, being cool to me meant being rational.
I do not wish to find myself opposing you. But if you continue on your present course, this confusing, inexplicable behavior
is my concern, not yours.
Being sensible, it meant being thoughtful. All of these, the antithesis of being violent, uncontrollable, destructive.
Spock, what is it that will buy you? Power.
Fascinating.